Welcome back to Fundamentals of Conflict Resolution and Peacebuilding. You know, normally I've been trying to do a shorter, more mini lectures for all of you, but occasionally it doesn't really work because I don't want to lose the flow and the entirety of what I'm sharing with you. And today is one of those days. I'm going to be, in addition to the movies that you're watching, particularly the Gandhi movie, but also if you're watching Boycott, the Birth of the Civil Rights Movement, or Cesar Chavez, his great boycott movement, I'm going to be going through some of the reasons that nonviolent resistance is such an important tool for conflict resolution and peace building in the world today. Now, it actually creates conflict with oppressors, dictators, and those who are intent on abusing us and ignoring our human rights. So it's healthy and important conflict. And you've seen some of it during the pandemic with the Black Lives Matter and the reproductive rights and some of the other movements that are sweeping the country and the world. But I want to take one day that I share the full entirety of it, at least in an introduction. I could teach an entire course or more than one course on this. But here's what I want to say for those of you who struggle with listening longer than 5 minutes to a lecture. Go ahead and shut the video off after 5 minutes. You can watch it in 5 minute blurbs. Some of you are not going to be that interested in nonviolent resistance, and that's okay. You all get to pick your interests and your goals in this course. There's a ton of possibilities because possibilities in aligning yourself with your passions and your strengths, your skills, your style, your personality, your history, life experience, they're at the heart of conflict resolution and peace building. So, you know, some of you are going to be very interested in nonviolent resistance, and you will excel in demonstrating that understanding to me in your papers, and others won't. You'll focus on the arts. I brought this other book, which I have not given you as an option, but it's a wonderful review of the literature with arts, creativity, and intercultural conflict resolution. And if some of you are interested, I'll get you Michelle LeBaron's information. You might just focus on the arts and conflict resolution and peace building, and you'll still excel. You are my co-collaborators and my partners in this teaching and learning. You get to individualize, custom design this course in the way that works best for you. So, that said, I'm about to take much longer with a video than I normally would. I hope some of you enjoy. Now, nonviolent protest movements have been studied by academics since Gandhi and the Indian people were able to liberate themselves from the British, who colonized and exploited, oppressed, and brutally treated the Indian people. You'll become more familiar as you watch these movies. People have been, academics, there's a whole circle of academics on fire with nonviolent resistance. And if some of you want to connect with some of them, please let me know. I can help you with that. It's important to know that nonviolent resistance is not just a protest in the street, right? It's not just, you know, our labor unions, the writers of Hollywood, the faculty and the staff of the CSU protesting that they want more money and benefits and all of that. Protests are a small piece of successful nonviolent resistance. And I've done my own protesting. I was part of the nuclear freeze movement. Obviously, we did not have the impact that we had hoped to have. And those of you who are able to see Oppenheimer are going to see the tragedy of that. But, you know, we are called to what I see as our destiny and our purpose in life. Obviously, Gandhi and Dr. King Jr. experienced that call. Cesar Chavez, Nelson Mandela, and Desmond Tutu. We all need to search within and ask, what do we care enough about to go the distance, to have moral courage and conviction, to transform others' apathy and resistance, criticism and attack. And so I'm not here to tell you what you're called to do, but I am deeply grateful for the activists who do feel that calling and care enough to go the distance. You're seeing a, you know, heroic example of this in Russia right now with the man who's currently imprisoned, who's been taking on Putin and the oppressive dictatorship in Russia. It's, now I've introduced, those of you reading Negotiation Alchemy have been introduced to the power of non-cooperation. You know, Gandhi got that, I think it was Thoreau, maybe it was Emerson, some of our transcendentalist philosophers, some of the people who stood up against slavery and were abolitionists during the time before our Civil War. We need to decide how we're going to erode the power base of those who are oppressing or preventing whatever it is that we're resisting. And, you know, I talk a lot about best alternative to a negotiated agreement as a way of empowering yourself, whether in a negotiation or in whatever personal situation you find yourself in. Dr. King used the U.S. Constitution and at that time the U.S. Supreme Court in order to advance the civil rights movement. Now, exposing injustice is critical. The role that whistleblowers and journalists play in letting people know the truth of what's going on. I don't know if you know the history of the CSU. Our students have been very powerful whistleblowers exposing injustice. They actually ousted one of our former chancellors who was misusing your tuition money and your student fees for his own, you know, cushy, lush parties. You need to look into that history. They went to the New York Times to expose what was going on. So we have some great history in the CSU. We need to be, any nonviolent movement needs to seek essential allies. And you will be seeing, those of you who have not taken the restorative justice course, GE with me, will be watching the documentary on South Africa's Truth and Reconciliation Commission, where Desmond Tutu, the Archbishop, rallied the world. He sought essential allies in going against apartheid in South Africa with the US and other powers of the world. And they all came together to boycott South Africa the way you've been seeing the world boycotting Russia in its current war. So we need to connect with those who can help our cause. This is not about staying within our own cozy inner circle, right? Just people we see as like us. This is about reaching out of our comfort zone and embracing building connections with people that we might see or label as enemy. I have an Armenian colleague who for years has been visiting Turkey secretly, to gain insight and explore possibilities. You know, if you know the history of the Armenian genocide in Turkey, this is very courageous peace building. And he is an inspirational man. I have a former student who is a Kenyan theologian and pastor who is trying to reach out to modern British people to explore ways they could do restorative justice and repair harm in Kenya. The British have always created a power base by dividing groups against each other in various countries around the world. That's why it's so important that we step outside of our own social identity and build relationships with what we call in peacebuilding the other. Because otherwise, though people intent on hurting us and destroying democracy will pit ethnic, religious, gender groups against each other to keep us weak. We can't allow that to happen. Now, the research is showing that nonviolent resistance, we're not just, you know, passionate about this because it sounds very inspirational and nice. The academic research is showing that armed struggle, civil war, is much less successful in building democracy, in building a sustainable movement forward than nonviolent resistance. You look at Syria, what a tragic situation. Iraq is another tragic situation. We're going to be seeing this with Russia as well. Overall, you know, look at North and South Korea as a tragic example where family has been separated from each other. While toxic masculinity, the patriarchy, likes to glorify and promote violence against each other, you know, look at all the Hollywood movies where we're glorifying the snipers. The truth is that we do very enormous damage to a nation state, a community, being able to rebuild and sustain itself. But nonviolent resistance is different. It's much more successful, and I'd like to say a little bit more. So if you're interested in this, my students, my graduate students in conflict resolution and peace building, study some of these real world case studies, not only India, but the Philippines, Poland, the Balkans. There are so many case studies of how nonviolent resistance has worked. But, you know, we normally don't hear about it or learn about it on the news, right? We get 5-minute, very short, exciting blurbs of violence on the news mostly. We don't learn about it unless we take the time to study it. And it succeeds with the most repressive regimes. So, you know, it results in greater freedoms for people. And let me describe some of this. The community building that is required for conflict resolution and peace building, the relationship building that is required, and normally it is multicultural interfaith. Sadly, India, you know, the Islamic Pakistanis, they wanted their own nation state, and that has led to horrific, you know, genocide violence. Gandhi, you know, was heartbroken with what happened because he was attempting to build a multicultural interfaith country, not a, you know, Hindu nationalist or Pakistani nationalist country. But where, you know, let's pick, what example can I give you? I guess I'm going to use the example of the United States, where people build a democracy that is multicultural and interfaith. They have to do in the nonviolent movement a lot of the same things that we need to do to sustain and maintain a healthy democracy. They have to get to know each other. They have to recognize that we all have strengths and weaknesses, and they have to strategically figure out how to work together to maximize strength and attack the weaknesses. So it's a democracy building exercise. And it must engage as much of the society as possible. You know, some of my students will say, well, the government in the US is responsible for our democracy? No. I have this discussion with my husband all the time. The citizens, we, the voters, are responsible for the democracy, and we have to provide critical oversight for all of the government representatives, politicians, as well as their staff and departments. Otherwise, it doesn't work. And when nonviolent resistance and democracy works well, diverse people come together with diverse ideas, with diverse skills, and I'm going to be talking about this more throughout the course. They create innovative new ways of strategizing and responding because of their diversity, not because they are homogeneous, segregated, separate from each other. I love these quotes, so I will read this. Running a campaign from central headquarters with a fixed ideology is not promising. Encouraging diversity and experimentation is. And everything you're being introduced to in this course is helping you with that. Now I'm quoting myself here. The difference between self-determination and witless submission lies in the ability to predict accurately the consequences of alternative courses of action. Sound familiar? That's reflective practice. That's action theory. We all, as adults, are asked to self-determine, mature, and grow up to figure out on a day-to-day basis what works for us and what doesn't, what works for our family and what doesn't. We must engage our moral imagination to be conflict resolvers and peace builders. We can't separate applied ethics from creativity, not with conflict resolution and peace building. We have to bring it together. And as I mentioned earlier, we have to build critical power alliances. We might need to include the military and the police, and I know that's a controversial discussion at Dominguez. I understand that. That's why I teach a course on restorative justice. I share your concerns about the military and the police, but we all have to figure out a way to optimally work together. Now, you know, if you've ever been, I brought the classic volume, The Art of War, to show you today, because military leaders study strategy. If any of you play chess or a similar game, you have to figure out how you're going to respond to your opponent's moves. That's what nonviolent resistance requires too. A leader who day-to-day is analyzing what the opponent is doing and figuring out what they are going to do in response. Now, you are living through an unprecedented time when we have had a U.S. president who has been indicted on several criminal charges because he was attempting to dismantle the democratic institutions that we have built or take over, dominate the political institutions that we have built over many generations. But you have watched, and I want to take this out of the overly simplistic framework of Republicans against Democrats, because most of you, like me, are independents in this country right now. We're sick to death of that overly simplistic thinking. What I want to say is the people in this country on all sides who care about the longevity and integrity of our democracy have been working very hard with countermoves in order to check and stop the criminality and corruption that we've seen. You must strategize. And, you know, I say it's the same for those of you who are married and want to stay married and have a, you know, a democratic marriage, a democratic family. And I'm not going to call my husband my opponent. He's not. He's my partner. But we must be constantly engaged and aware of what's going on in our family lives, right? And figure out, okay, how are we going to respond to create the harmonious vision that we have of our time together? And as I've mentioned, you must have the staying power and the resilience. And all of you understand this. Look at you. You know, a 50% or more of our students have defied the odds and faced so many obstacles in their lives. But they had the staying power and the ability, the resilience to succeed and come to university college to empower themselves and succeed. So you understand this in a very deep and intimate way. And what I'd like to say, I've spoken enough and I've introduced enough of nonviolent resistance with my PowerPoint. You're going to see more on your Canvas module to help you with this, is what would you attempt to do in this world if you knew you could not fail? Because these are some of the questions that will help you identify what you care most about. Thank you for listening. Have a wonderful week.